When NASA launches into orbit, they get years to build the payload, months to inspect the rocket, and a four-day countdown. When you're launching a Titan II Cold War nuclear missile, you get 3 minutes. I'm in Silo 8, 10 meters beneath the Arizona desert, and we've just received orders to end the world. If the order to launch our missile ever came, then it would be received by that antenna. It looks like a disc stuck on top of a cone, which is what gives it the unimaginative name of disc cone antenna. The shape lets it receive a wide range of different frequencies across the entire horizon, which makes it incredibly resilient to jamming. That said, you could still knock it over with a well-placed truck, so there are a couple of backups. Be not afraid, for we have a backup low-frequency, low-bandwidth spherics antenna buried underground. This is able to receive any message, just really, really slowly. There are also some pop-up antennas which get deployed as needed. In order to spot any uninvited guests, we have the TPS-39s, or Tipsies. Today, they're guarding the AC unit, but back in the day, it was a vent taking fresh air into the silo. A beam of radio waves is emitted from one to the other, forming an invisible wall. If anything passes through, this tips off an alarm, and a team is sent out to chase off what is either a Soviet spy or Wile E. Coyote. The only way in is through this hatch, which will take us down 10 flights of steps. There were 58 of these silos scattered across the United States, each housing a Titan II missile with enough firepower to fight World War II three times over, including the nuclear bits. Because of this, if the Cold War ever got hot, striking one of these stations would have been priority number one for the Soviets. Therefore, it needed to be built to be able to survive an attack, most likely a nuclear attack, and then come back fully armed and operational. As we reach the bottom of our staircase, we reach the hardened bit of the bunker, starting out with two massive blast doors. These are made of welded I-beams, able to survive a 70 bar overpressure. For context, your house can survive about 0.2 bar overpressure, meaning these things are insanely strong. The doors are opened in sequence like an airlock, to ensure that no blast can ever get through. Once we're through that entranceway, we reach the corridor. Down that way is the command center, which is used to launch the missile. And 50 meters that way, down this corridor, is the missile itself. Let's go take a look. There are two key things we need to protect against during a nearby nuclear strike. First of all is the percussive impact. To protect against that, the walls and floors are up to 1.5 meters thick of reinforced concrete. The structure is sort of domed in shape, which will help to redirect that energy. Now, you'll notice that I'm not walking on the concrete directly, but rather a sort of steel raised platform. This and everything else in the facility of any sort of importance, including the missile itself, is being held aloft and supported by these massive shock absorbers. These allow the structure to rattle and roll, but it won't break. Any of the cables and all the piping also has a lot of extra slack, allowing it to move around a bit without becoming severed. The next thing we need to worry about is the electromagnetic pulse which comes from the bomb. This could be even more deadly, as it would destroy any of our sensitive electronics. To protect against that, everything is encased in up to a centimeter of battleship-grade steel, which, like a Faraday cage, will redirect the pulse. All the wiring also passes through these EMP shields, sort of like a surge protector, which will stop that pulse from destroying our sensitive electronics. Surviving the first strike, it's time to retaliate. And we do that with this thing, the Titan II missile in her natural habitat. The goal of our missile is to launch and get out of the silo as quickly as possible. And in that way, the Titan II is a significant improvement over its predecessor, the Titan I. In all ways except payload, a ICBM is practically identical to a space rocket. With NASA's upcoming Artemis missions, the actual rocket is being powered by a mixture of hydrogen as the fuel and oxygen as the oxidizer. For the real rocket, they're used in their ultra-energy dense, super cool liquid forms. And after it gets loaded in, you can see some of it boiling off and being vented out. If you were to load the rocket too early, then it would all just evaporate and you'd have to cancel the launch. Fortunately, today I'm using them in their gaseous forms, so we're not going to need to worry. The hydrogen and oxygen get combined in the engine. For the moment, they're fine, but to ignite it, we need a spark. It takes 9 hours to fuel up Artemis, requiring an insane amount of support infrastructure. While that might be okay for a space mission, it is entirely unacceptable for a missile. Instead, the Titan 1 substitutes the liquid hydrogen for kerosene. As you can see, it's a liquid at room temperature, meaning that it could come pre-installed. Unfortunately, the kerosene plus oxygen reaction isn't quite as reactive as oxygen plus hydrogen, but it was a fair trade-off. After getting the order to launch, the procedure was to fill the remaining tank with 90,000 tons of liquid oxygen. This took about 15 minutes, then lift the thing out of the silo, taking 5, and only then actually have it ignite. It was a good procedure, but there was still room for significant improvement. Titan 2 uses a completely different class propellant, known as hypergolics. The reagents were aerosene as the fuel and dinitrogen tetroxide as the oxidizer. Because these were both liquid at room temperature, they could come 100% preloaded. I'm using Mentos and Coke today though, because the real things are way too dangerous for me to be playing with. A benefit of this though, is that you didn't need a fancy igniter to start the reaction. All you needed to do is bring them together. Another speed up that we had is that rather than having to lift the actual rocket outside the silo, bring it to ground level and then launch, instead we would do the entire reaction and launch inside the silo itself. And yeah, as you might be able to guess, it did get incredibly messy. As our friends over at SpaceX recently found out, a rocket can really tear apart your launch pad. And although this one was only designed for single use, you do need the missile to actually leave the silo before said silo falls apart. A water deluge system directly beneath the engines captures most of the vibration, and thick sound tiles lined along the sides of the silo capture the rest. A W-shaped wedge redirects exhaust up and out. Of course, none of that can happen without the carefully choreographed dance of death going on in the command center. So we've survived the first strike, and we've got our missile. It's time for the mutual bit of mutually assured destruction. This is the command center. You need to have 4 people here at all times: the commander, deputy commander, and 2 enlisted personnel. Upstairs is where we have the crew quarters. You could sleep or make something to eat. And downstairs is where we have some power generation, as well as backup coffee reserves. And here is the command level. You need to have 2 personnel here at all times, one of whom was either the commander or deputy commander. Take a seat. Let's launch a missile. Our message comes in through the radios, and then you immediately start writing down what you hear. Once you've written it down, you switch it with whoever's running this station, and you double check to see that you've both got the same message. At around this time, the spherics antenna would probably have received its message as well, and that'll give you a 3rd point of confirmation. If those match, we then head over to this safe. You open your lock, the deputy commander opens theirs, and out of the safe, you get a cookie. Breaking open the cookie gives us some more characters, which we'll use to decode that original message. This gives us instructions of where we're targeting. We can either select from 3 pre-programmed destinations, or put in a new one using ticker tape. We need to put in the code for a butterfly valve, located in the oxidizer line of the rocket. Without it, we cannot physically launch the missile. We also flip a circuit breaker over here, which charges up the onboard flight computer. The missile is now ready for 1 final confirmation. The commander has 1 key, deputy commander the other. You cannot reach between the 2 of them, I have tried. On 3, we turn them. 3. It's now out of our hands. The batteries activate, silo doors slide open. Targeting is handed over to the onboard computer. The engines ignite, and we're off. Stage 1 lifts our rocket to 80 kilometers up and 80 north. Stage 2, 300 up and 650 north. Eventually, we reach 1200 kilometers, three times the height of the International Space Station, with the Stage 3 vernier engine adjusting trajectory so that it hits our target to within an accuracy of 900 meters. Really, really ruining someone's day. Inside the silo, there are a couple of fires that need putting out and blast doors that need to be closed. But beyond that, the instructions are to await further orders. Orders from a government that may no longer exist. Down here, there's enough oxygen and food to last for about a month. But what happens afterwards? Do you stay here and suffocate, or climb up the escape shaft and into the unknown? This has been James Dingley from the Atomic Frontier. Keep looking up.